Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to another video. This video, I'm going to try to be as quick as possible while trying to explain exactly what it is we're doing here today on Unraid. If you are, however, watching this video on Debian Linux, I highly suggest visiting the Discord for Crossseed, or alternatively, even visiting their website. Again, these videos are meant to be a conceptual guide, because a lot of the times the concept and certain technical stuff about the conceptual pitfalls that can happen about setting this up. So I will cover very specific technical stuff that caught me off guard with Crossseed, so that you, once you read the documentation, can set it up without running into the same mistakes that I did as a newcomer to Crossseed. So what's Crossseed? Well, do you know when you download a torrent or a movie or a TV show from one website, right? And usually if you're on a private tracker, that website has a ratio. So if you grab a TV or a movie show from one website, you kind of want to help build, depending on a tracker, your ratio on another website. And a lot of websites, when you seed or when you share, you get a higher, you know, you get something called bonus points. And then those bonus points you can trade for upload credit, usually. Not always. But what Crossseed allows you to do is it allows you to leverage your media server setup, which includes obviously a download client, right? Like Deluge, RTorrent, QubitTorrent, and utilize that natural environment to share the same torrent data across multiple websites without having to manually go to like three different trackers, check if they have that torrent, save the torrent, load the torrent. You know, if you have more than like five, that's going to become really tedious really quickly. So Crossseed is usually done through Docker. If you don't know what I'm talking about, please, please go check out my Docker video and Docker Compose video. It's more Debian Linux specific and not necessarily Unraid, but it's a good conceptual guide to what Docker is and Docker Compose, of course. So again, Crossseed can run two ways. Crossseed can run as a manual search. However, its full power is unlocked by something called Daemon mode. So Daemon mode is essentially, it runs Crossseed 24/7 and searches for Crossseeds as soon as new torrents are added. And, you know, pretty much that. Race starting at 100% before the uploader even joins. So what does this mean, race starting at 100%? What this means is, if you want to be in the race against a bunch of seed boxes grabbing the same thing on a certain website, you can already have 100% before even the uploader themselves joins. Now, this is assuming that the uploader on this tracker got their this particular torrent from another tracker that you also got it from. So you can kind of make sure that you kind of fight for, you know, upload credit, even though realistically, you know, a seed box is probably going to crush everybody eventually. Very quickly. So again, let's get seeding. Okay. So how do you do this whole thing? So there's several ways. So to install it, all you want to go is go to community applications. If you don't know what this is, you get it on Unraid forms, you install it. It's the marketplace. It's like Google Play Store for Unraid. I'm hoping you guys saw my 2-hour, 30-minute video on media servers, because this none of this lingo should be something I have to keep explaining. So there's like a little prerequisite there. If a lot of this stuff is like you're not sure, head over to my 2-hour, 30-minute video guide and then come back. So now, what does it do? So we're gonna type Crossseed right here, and we're gonna go right to AmbiPro. So this is the official image for Crossseed right here, AmbiPro. We're going to hit action and we're going to install it. It's going to ask you which version. You're going to choose Crossseed latest, and then it's going to bring up stuff like this. So this is the container and this is what it looks like. First, let's take a look at this container, just kind of how it is by default. So this is what the container looks like by default. And, you know, if you read the wiki on CrossSeat, so there is a wiki. So right here under options, you can see what's required. What's required is Tor's NAB, torrent directory, and output directory. Okay. So if you go under CrossSeat, you'll get a configuration file. Okay. So let's scroll up on this configuration file. So this CrossSeat utilizes, let's say it's basically a script. Okay. Like a lot of Docker things, it's a script, and the script runs, give or take, if you do daemon mode, right? It can be 24/7, or you can run it manually. So they do actually on their guide show you how to run it manually, but it's a little long-winded. You have to define the torrent directory, the output directory, the torsnab. Easiest thing I can say is CrossSeat works in terms of two modes, okay? Not just manual search and daemon mode. Let's say those are how it runs, but there are two modes within CrossSeat. One is considered torrent matching or torrent linking, okay? Torrent matching simply searches the trackers for similar files with the exact same name and size as the searchy. So searchy is what you already have. It starts looking for candidates on a website. And so it looks for candidates and it essentially analyzes the list of files in them. So the structure has to match. It has to have exact names and sizes. So imagine a one-to-one. And torrent matching mode does not create hard links or any sort of links. Now you're probably like, well, why are you bringing the word links up? Because it applies to data matching. So with torrent linking, not only does the file structure have to match, meaning it has to be a top level file, but it has to have the same exact name and size. So that's the torrent linker version. So if CrossSeat were to search, let's say these are your downloads, okay, not CrossSeat's, and CrossSeat looks at Mickey's Magical Christmas, okay, and it goes to all your trackers that you define in the config file through the torsnab links. Again, how does it know which trackers? Torsnab, right here, you're gonna define, number 6 for Prowler is, you know, FTN, etc. And so Torsnab checks your indexers, RSS thing, and it wants something with the exact same. We're going to go under content. We're going to look at Mickey's Magical Christmas. So again, notice how it's right at the top. So it's going to rely on that. If there's a folder with the name Mickey's Magical Christmas or whatever, it will not work. So again, look at this right here. For one, torrent-based searches are limited to the top-level directory, meaning the file has to be here. One thing I want to say about torrent matching mode is that you can have that as a primary with a fallback to database-based matching for the contents of a certain torrent. So if torrent-based matching can't find a torrent based on the info hash, it will go towards the database matching if you have it set up for that. By default, both matching modes work together in tandem unless you choose to force one type of mode, which I'll show later. For the default torrent mode, if you don't have the .torrent files, that can be kind of problematic. If the .torrent files don't exist, torrent linking won't work. So that's another thing with torrent linking. Again, if it's not an exact match with name and size, it will not torrent link match CrossSeat. It won't find the CrossSeat through torrent linking. One thing to note before we get into database matching is that even though it can be more effective for some situations, depending on the trackers you utilize, you can have consistent info hash matching through the torrent matching method. If you don't have consistent trackers, then you're going to want to pay attention to this next part. That's why there's database matching. What does that mean? Well, in simple terms, database matching, if you have something where there's a lot of folders, okay, like right here in Cool Runnings, right, there's a folder. Data linking can go into the folder and go into it, like really go into it. If there's several folders, let's say a proof folder, subs folder, it can look through even those folders. And moreover, database matching is a lot more aggressive. So that's one of the things that they're saying here. Database matching opens the door for risky matching with the, where the name of the searchee can be ignored and only file size is used. So again, there's two modes, risky and safe, that both first look at the size of the candidate. Now, the size of the candidate, you could give it some leeway in terms of configuration. So if we look here, there's something called fuzzy size threshold of 0.02 or 2%, right? So it will give a 2% leeway. So something is, let's say, 4 gigs, 2% of that, it will go up or down, and it will then move on to the next sort of attribute that it looks at, which is the release groups. So safe mode requires the release groups to be a perfect match, in addition to the third attribute that they both look at is the file tree. Risky, on the other hand, it matches on just the size with the fuzzy threshold attribute, but it doesn't really care about the release groups being there or not. How does database matching work? Well, database matching works by defining a data directory. And one of the things is, if you don't understand what symlink or hardlink is, you know, I'm actually gonna be making a separate video for that, because I think it kind of deserves like a shorter separate video. But I'm gonna assume you do know what symlink and hardlink is. So CrossSeed, when it loads these other torrents, it doesn't point it to, obviously, you know, especially if it's data matched, right? The name might be different, the structure might be different. So it creates links. So you can symlink, which it says recommended here, but they remove that because it's a preference. You can choose symlink or you can do hardlink. So you can hardlink the data matched CrossSeeds into the CrossSeeds directory that I showed earlier in the container. So it's a personal preference, which one you want to do. There's no real right or wrong answer here, but I do hardlink like radar and sonar. And again, match mode is one of those things, safe or risky. Risky only uses the file size, and safe uses the existing method of name plus file sizes. Okay. So that's, and again, look at this. So you can even determine how much depth it can traverse. So if it looks, if it sees a torrent name, it can go, you know, see, it can go either to number two, it can go, you know, to even, you know, the subfolders, which is, this is the second depth, right? Torrent's the first, these are in the second. And then third would be something inside of the torrent's subfolder. So of course, if you set it higher than two, it might generate a larger than intended number of searchees that may not get results. Here they explain, why do we even link? Again, the reason that there's linking is because it allows CrossSeed to add torrents that do not have the same name or structure as the original torrent that you downloaded. So they do mention that while Qubit Torrent supports renaming, it's not supported on all clients, so linking is a more robust solution. And again, all matches will be put into link directory. Again, I'm going to go over the conceptual of that in the config when we get to it. For this video, if you want to do torrent linking, I will leave that to you guys, because I feel like database matching is more robust. It's kind of where I've left it at. Of course, the developers, what they recommend is, hey, for initially you should do database, and then you should, for torrents going forward, you should go on to torrent linking. And they're going to make updates to make that a lot more, you know, effective and what have you. Though, honestly, for me, I think I'll just always stick to database, but your mileage may vary. So we're here in Qubit Torrent. If we take a look here, first of all, notice my categories. Now, if you guys, let me explain what these categories are, because in the media video, I didn't have these many categories. But for CrossSeed, I suggest that you add a CrossSeed category. So these are the directories you have: CrossSeed blank, CrossSeeds, and CrossSeed torrents. Ignore my orphan data one, that's for Qubit Manager. We're gonna talk about that later in another video. I suggest you create these three, and I'm gonna go into why. And finally, create the CrossSeed category. And have this cross seed category save into your cross seeds, okay? Now, obviously, I'm creating the category cross seed like this. Now, cross seed by default, the script uses a default category of cross dash seed dash data. So, you know, if you wanted, you could just do to start with, you could just do it this way. But of course, I just went into the config. I looked at the config first and I did it this way. And it's up to you if you want to use the default. I used cross seed. Up to you guys. And that points that to cross seeds or whatever directory you specified for the cross seeds in the container. And then of course I created a seed only, category. This is something I created because, you know, what if I don't want a movie necessarily on radar, right? Or a TV show on sonar. And I decide, you know, I downloaded it, but I just don't want to see them anymore. So I remove them, right? But the problem is the original torrents still have the category, the radar or sonar pickup on movies, movies 4K, TV, TV 4K. So I made a separate category, called seed only that I can just dump stuff into that I still wanted to seed for bonus point reasons, but I don't want radar or sonar to show them anymore, period. So once you have everything kind of matching mine, you can ignore these tags. This is for Qubit Manager. We're going to talk that in another video. Cross seed, this is going to happen from the script. So all you should see is all and untagged. Now let's head on over to the container again. We see a config. It creates an app data, cross seed. We see torrent dir. What does this mean? Again, torrent dir, even though this is cross seed blank, this is the directory for the torrent client, which I want to exclusively use data mode. I have to point it at a blank folder that doesn't have torrents in it. This assumes that you don't want to use torrent matching at all. Torrent matching does use data for, you know, candidates that it couldn't match a torrent for. But again, if you are using like the BT backup, it needs to be empty. Otherwise, it will always prefer torrent mode first. Torrent mode will always take priority. So if you have pointed it to here, right, in torrenter, and you're not wanting to use torrent matching as the mode for a cross seed, then you need to create a blank directory. Otherwise, it will always prefer the torrent file. And then all those torrent matching configuration options will apply. So now remember, cross seed has two modes, right? It has torrent matching mode and data matching mode. Output directory can be used for either of these matching. And in some cases like our torrent injection, which we'll cover later, it requires an output directory to be specified. Now for data matching, if you use the save action instead of inject action, which is injecting the cross seed into your torrent client, it will always utilize the output directory. And in the cases of just torrent matching mode, this is the directory that it will store the .torrent files of the cross seeds that either you specify to inject or not. Now let's talk about injection. So cross seed does support something called direct client injection. So again, this is something that, you know, it can inject right into if it finds it, you know. Again, you need to set your action option to inject or save. So if you don't want it to inject and you want it to always save into, let's say a watch directory, then you do save. Inject is if it can communicate with your torrent client because you're on Unraid. I'm hoping that's why you're watching this video. But I just wanted to show you guys that those are the two options. You know, you set your qubit torrent link option and then you start cross seed. It will tell you if it connected to qubit torrent. And again, it will do direct injection. Output directory will still be used in those cases if it, for some reason, let's say failed, I was told output directory acts as a fallback for the torrent files that weren't injected. Now, data directory. Okay. So you guys know how sometimes in like templates, like if you saw the 2-hour, 20-minute video, there's portions where I tell you, hey, add something, add a pull path, a port or variable, because it wasn't defined in the template. So this is one of those situations where in the config file, and I want to put that here before we even look at the config file, but it's super important because there is in the guide, okay, in the guide, if we go down, there's something that they talk about and it's called the link directory, right? So for database mode, link directory is where it puts your links, your hard linked files, okay? So this link directory, again, see, it says you will need to mount the volume for cross-seed to have access to data directory and link directory. So data directory is wherever your torrent data is, right? For movies or TV shows, data torrents. So this is my data directory. You see what I'm saying? But in here, you know, you data torrents is fine. But I added, you know, a link dir, because I saw it in the config file right here, where I thought, oh, it needs to be defined, the link dir. And this is my link directory. So I thought, oh, I better define it because the program's going to want to see it mapped or something, right? No, wrong. Do not do that because you're going to get an error because you'll be creating two volumes. And that's going to be a really big problem later on when it's trying to link. Because Docker, remember, all these things on the left, when they're a path, right? It's basically creating, it's treating this like its own hard disk or like its own virtual file system, right? Under data /torrent. So if you create link dir, okay, because I did that, I created a link directory and I had it set to pretty much what was set here, data torrents cross seeds. And then so I had container path data torrents cross seeds, and then the host was mount user data torrents cross seeds. It wasn't able to hard link because those are considered two different volumes by Docker. So do not do that. Just leave, again, this property refers to just, again, just the it needs to be only in the configuration file. Really important. Data directory can be set to data/torrents. Now you guys are probably wondering, in the previous videos when I talk about persistent data path, right? I was talking about /torrents being /data/torrents, always with data, right? So one of the things that I really realized about Docker is you only really want to keep super consistent paths is if you think something is some other container application needs to be able to read or write from a certain other application's volume mapping path. So if there was another application that was trying to look under for, you know, that needed to talk to, you know, again, this path variable for this container, then you want to be persistent. Here, what is this one doing? It's simply just pointing to the qubit torrent directory. So I don't think anything would want to talk to this. So that's why I just left it the way it was, /torrents. Same thing with /crossseeds. I left it the way it was. Also because in the directory, in the config, they do mention, don't change this for Docker. Don't change torrent directory. Don't change this for Docker, the output directory. So they wouldn't write that unless they were sure it's not going to break some crap. So I trusted it, and so that's pretty much it. So again, a cross seeds pointed it right to cross seed. There's no data /torrents /cross seeds, right? So I just left it /cross seed torrents, right? Simple. Because again, the only thing looking at these is itself. Cross seed is the only thing looking at /torrents and /cross seeds. You don't really have to worry about anything else trying to go into these container paths. Yes, there will be, let's say, qubit torrent that might, you know, need to go under cross-seed torrents if that's your watch directory, right? Let's say for deluge or qubit torrent, you set that as your watch directory because you set the mode for cross-seed to save. So it's going to store matched files in there, you know? So even then, you know, in that case, you should be fine too. Because again, and you're going to define that within, you know, within your KubeTorrent mount inside of the app. So you don't have to say /crossseats because KubeTorrent doesn't really have a /crossseats, right? You didn't put one in there if you followed it the way I did it. You're going to want to head into your config file. Now the config file is neato, right? So again, let's go to the top of the config file. There's a delay. And this is the time between searches. There's your torsnap. You're going to put the torsnap links for whichever indexers you want to search cross seats for. Torsnap. What is torsnap? Well, you know the indexers, right? So Jacket or Prowler, give or take. Once you get the torsnap link, this is essentially the RSS, right? It's RSS. It's an RSS thing where you can query RSS for certain releases. So remember, crossseat is a script and it needs to search a torsnap or in order to, you know, check your indexers for torrents that are in your torrent client that are potential matches, which crossseat refers to as searchees and candidates. Searchees are obviously what you already have and candidates are usually on the indexer. This would be an excellent time to mention to you guys that your tracker can get really, really mad at you if you snatch too many .torrent files. I actually had this happen to me. I got banned on a really popular torrent site that said I grabbed a crap load of .torrent files. Now, it wasn't related to crossseat, but it is a good little side note here. So again, this is where we want to reduce the number of unnecessary snatches of .torrent files as much as possible. One of those is obviously include episodes, include single episodes. We're going to talk about these ones. These are really applicable to like a TV tracker. Include non-video files. You can also utilize exclude older and exclude recent search. We're going to cover that in detail later. And then of course, you can always, the final limiters that you can do is search limit and also search cadence. And search cadence applies to either torrent matching or data matching. And it's essentially to catch some things that fell through the crack or again, as a limiting option. So when you combine search limit and search cadence, in addition to a few other ones, it'll help, you know, make sure that you don't get banned. And of course, here's a recommendation for a really popular TV site, BTN, where they they spoke to the staff and they kind of came up with this one. But again, this is just an example. Data DIRs. So what is data directory? This is where your torrents are, which is where the data is. So again, I'm going to tell you guys for data DIRs, whether it's torrent linking or data matching mode, you want this filled out. So for me, I just did movies and TV shows. Match mode, I did risky. And by default, even with risky, there's no risk of ruining your ratio because crossseat is set up in a way where no additional downloads really happen. Even if, let's say, it accidentally made a false positive match through torrent mode, data matching backup, or even data only mode by tricking it with a crossseat blank torrent directory. We can use something called skip recheck for database matches, which I'll discuss later. Data category, notice, remember when I told you to create that in KubeTorrent? We're gonna put that in here, crossseat. So again, what categories are those torrents put as? So I labeled them crossseat because I wanna know they're the crossseats. Also, yeah, right, you don't wanna call it movies or TV because then radar and sonar are just gonna start picking those up and that's no good. Now, if you are doing just torrent linking, I'm just going to mention it right here. If you're doing just torrent linking, there's a variable in here called duplicate. Here we go. Duplicate categories. And they mention that in their guide, something with in their guide. They mention, hey, you know, don't, you know, there's a real problem with Rs right here. R users injection. There's a potential problem with duplication of imports using either an R on downgrade or upgrade. the whole point of this is that you don't want it to inject the torrents, right? With the name, let's say movies, right? Movies. You see what I'm saying? With the movies here. Cause what's going to happen is Radar will pick that up. So anytime a crossfeed gets added, Radar will think it's a new torrent and it'll try to import it. And so there's duplications there. It's going to get stuck and all that. So that's all this whole spiel is saying is that, hey, listen, if you're doing torrent linking mode, you want to enable this. Torrent linking mode utilizes the same source torrent. Again, remember, because it has to be an exact match. So it doesn't create any links. So it will save to that same category, right? It will still have wherever your movies is. In my case was just the movies folder. It will still create that cross seed in the movies save path, but it will add that cross seed tag at the end. So it'll be movies.crossseed. Also, it won't add a duplicate into Radar that would confuse it. So now I remember I said I was only going to do data directory setup, but I do want to still mention things for people who don't want to do data matching. So again, if you're doing torrent matching, be wary of the ours thing. You really want to enable duplicate categories. Link directory. Remember, link directory is how it makes the links. So a different link for every different file or directory structure, there's going to be, you know, it's a way to kind of create a faux data structure for a torrent that it's trying to cross seed. You see how I have Dawn of the Dead here in a folder, but let's say the torrent that I originally had just had Dawn of the Dead. So if it detects, hey, on this tracker, it's in a folder and then there's the, you know, the file, then it will create a folder and then the file. So that's what linking is. It's always trying to either symlink or hard link. Link type. What type do you want to link? You can either do symlink or hard link. I personally went with hard link, like the server apps. Again, if you don't know the difference, it's in another video. Now here's the skip recheck function. If you look right here, my database results are paused at 100% after injection. Yes, because look, this is by design. This is done to prevent automatically downloading missing files or files that failed rechecking. Again, it injects, right? The script runs, it finds candidates, it injects in the qubit torrent, and one more time before it starts it up and revs it up, it checks that file to make sure it's a correct match. So it will always pause those torrents. So until there's a way to guarantee you won't end up downloading extra data, not cross-seeding, this is the best solution. So if you don't want to inject in a pause state, you can just enable skip recheck. You could set it to true. But again, you know, I personally would not skip it. I don't skip it. So again, another thing is I don't race to like upload either. I'm not really racing as well. But you know, if you want to race, that's up to you. Developers told me, they said, hey, do data for the initial and then switch to torrent injection. But again, it's still dependent on a perfect name match top level. So I don't do it. And plus a lot of uploaders, they'll like change the folder and stuff like that. So to me, I don't do torrent linking. Again, I don't do torrent linking mode. Max depth too. So go into a folder and look in there. That's what that means. Remember the three tiers. Torrent directory. Again, this is where those torrents are, right? For the client. So that's torrent dir. Output directory. Remember, this is where it's going to put its own torrent files. So if you're under doing action save mode, this is where it's going to put those torrent files. Include episodes and include single episodes. So this one is a little confusing, but it makes complete sense. This is going to try and search for all episode torrents inside of season packs and then try to like find individual torrents. So let's say you have True Detective season 4, episode 1, 2, 3, 4. Let's say that's a season pack, but if there's like a torrent with just season 4, episode 1, it's going to try to create a cross seed from your season pack. This strains indexers and creates a lot of queries, which could get you banned. So just set that to false. At least I do. Include single episodes. Again, creates a lot of queries. Do you really want to cross-seed a single episode? Is it really going to make or break your ratio? Probably not. So I set that to false. Now, here they kind of tell you, hey, look, to search for everything except episodes, use false, false, and true. Again, include torrents which contain non-video files. Non-video files. So again, if there's a subtitle, if there's, you know, let's take a look here. Remember, guys, if I don't answer it, the guide most certainly does. This video is just a supplement, so always check the guide. If your torrent contains a .info or a .srt or text, otherwise it will be outright ignored. So in that case, you probably want to hit include non-video if you think, hey, my tracker does a lot of those, you know, puts a subtitle in there, an info in there. But mine don't, so I put false. You can put true. So again, you'd be following more of this first one. To search for everything except episodes. To search for everything including episodes. To search for everything except season pack episodes. Data-based. So again, then you would do include single episodes, but no season pack episodes. So false, true, true. Personally, I'm in the three false gang. Fuzzy size threshold. This is, again, fuzzy size match for like giving some leeway or variance to the size. Remember, in terms of matching mode, risky or safe, it first looks at the size. So 2% will allow you a little leeway in terms of the size of the torrent that it's looking at. Okay. Now these next two are very confusing, but let me try and explain this because in the best way possible. Crossseed runs on Docker. And if you hit the advanced options under the container, you can change the default option from daemon mode, which is automatic 24/7, to running it just one time, which is the search mode. Now we're gonna stick to daemon mode. And daemon mode is the automatic mode, and it needs to have certain parameters that control how often it basically asks your indexers for certain crossseed candidates. That's defined by two variables in the configuration file. That's defined by, again, it's the RSS cadence and search cadence. So it's defined in the configuration as 10 min, 2W, 2 weeks, 3 days, like this. And so essentially, it can control whether in torrent matching mode or data matching mode, how it's going to periodically check these sources for the crossseed. One important thing to note is that when you're doing data-based matching, search cadence is what's prevalent. Data-based matching mode does not have support for RSS cadence, according to the developers. As for the default torrent matching behavior, search cadence is more for like periodic searches of things that perhaps RSS did not catch. So usually this is something that you can set to like 30 weeks. In fact, in the guide, I believe they mentioned 26 weeks for search cadence, but you could altogether just get rid of it if you want. But remember, search cadence is one of those things that can be utilized to also limit the number of searches that you're doing to the indexers, separate from your RSS searches. But if you did data matching mode only by pointing it to a blank directory with no torrents, right, for the torrent dir, then the only thing that will be relevant for you would be search cadence. Again, that's not to say that torrent matching mode only uses RSS cadence. It can use both. So pretend day one you add a torrent. Day two, 24 hours later, which is our search cadence in this example, right? And I'm only speaking in terms of data matching mode, right? Not the default behavior of crossseed. It runs and it checks for crossseeds. Now, day three, it will basically look back 3 days, day two, day one, day zero, and it won't check that one again. Day four, same thing. It'll look at 3, 2, 1. It'll say, oh, that's within 3 days. I won't check it again. Day five, the day one torrent is still within 3 days, right? The first scan was on day two. See? 1, 2, 3, so it's still there. So exclude recent search means anything more than 3 days, essentially, since it searched. Day 6, because it's finally been more than 3 days, right? 3 plus 2 is 5. Day 5 was technically the third day, the 3 day limit. And then day 6, it can finally search. Now, if we were to have done, instead of exclude older of 4 days, exclude older means, hey, listen, if it's been more than 4 days, right, then never check it again. So let's pretend this, instead of 4, it said 3, right? So if it said 3, then what that would mean is that even though on day 6 it's running and exclude recent search of 3 days is like, hey, this day 2-1 is safe to search. If exclude older says 3 days on it, right? If it says 3 days on it, on day six, it will never check that torrent ever again, because now it's officially older than 3 days. Now, one of the things that I know that was a little confusing for me was I said, well, if exclude older than 3 days applies to this, you know, the cross seed in general and like a database, what if I add a new tracker and, you know, exclude older than 3 days, how would I get it to pick that up? So the developers explained to me that these exclude recent and exclude older is per tracker. So you don't have to worry too much, which is really cool. So now that we covered exclude older and exclude recent search, again, action, inject. Queue BitTorrent, you're gonna put your username and password here, and then at localhost or your IP address if it's not on the same Docker network. Again, this video assumes you know Docker networking. If not, check out my video on that. Duplicate categories for the torrent linking. Port, API auth true, keep this on, okay? And again, what is API auth true? And we're gonna now cover that one. So API auth true is for torrents that just finished downloading. So set up automatic searches for finished downloads. So it's a script that runs and checks your existing torrents, right? Well, yes, but the most powerful feature of Daemon Mode is also the ability to search for cross seeds as soon as a torrent finishes downloading. How cool is that? As soon as it finishes downloading. So how does it work? Well, it's very simple. You go into your, you know, one of the things I want to say is this was a little harder than the guide, and this is another pitfall, is that I was unable to really run this command because this when the script first runs, right? When the script first runs, it starts checking your RSS if you have torrent linking enabled, or it starts checking for data. It'll check, you know, even though I had search cadence completely off, RSS off, it still kept searching. So might be a glitch on my end, might be something I overlooked, but what I did to counteract that was all the way up here to get that, I just put delay of 3000 with a comma. Never forget these commas at the end, guys, because then you're gonna get a lot of errors. Never ever forget these commas. Everything must have a comma after it, everything in this JavaScript file. config.javascript is how they do it. So it always should have a comma after. So I was finally able to access Unraid through this. And so we type, you know, what they said, docker exec cross h, then you see that. But if the script is running, you see an error. So that's no good. So you then type cross seed API key, right? It'll give you a string, a variable, a string. You're gonna take that string, and depending on which download client you have, rTorrent, Transmission, Deluge, I highly, highly recommend you guys follow this written tutorial. But you're gonna add, for, let's say for my instance, it was qBitTorrent, you're gonna add something like this in the qBitTorrent section under run external program. You can do name-based for, you know, name-based or info hash-based, but for database, you wanna do path. And so name-based info hash, this is more for like, again, torrent linking. I should stop saying linking, torrent matching, dot torrent matching. But really that's why they say, hey, look, the method of search we recommend info hash is recommended. okay? But again, it requires the BT backup folder from QBitTorrent to be mounted to TorrentDir, or it will not work. So again, remember, these are those options that must be defined either way. TorrentDir, OutputDir, TorsNap. You must define it. Of course, I also recommend data category, data DIRs. Again, this data DIRs is more for data-based searching. Where is it looking in for data? So for data-based matching, data DIRs is required. Data categories is required. Link DIR is required. I believe those are 100% required. And of course, you also want to do your search cadence, because remember, database mode, no RSS matching. And so that's pretty much everything that I really wanted to cover. Oh, and one thing about the API key, it changes. So if you're getting errors on your log about invalid or unauthorized API web access from 172.0, that's probably your torrent client trying to do these commands right here for automatic searches. If for any reason you have to remove the crossseed.db, just know that your API key changes. So you're probably going to want to update that or keep, cognizant of that. I usually save my API key in the config file. You see right here, API key for me right here, but I removed it for this video. But to pivot, if you use this video to do data-based matching for Crossseed by tricking it into checking a blank torrenter, right, so that it can't do torrent-based matching, if you're one of your indexers for data-based matching already exist in your torrent client, then when it goes to data match the existing torrents from the data directory, right? From the data directory, for example, movies or TV, it will see that, oh, for FTN over here, the Black Cauldron already exists. And if you already have, let's say, an indexer with torrents loaded up and you're doing data only mode, it will scan, and then it will scan the same indexer, and then it will attempt to create a link to it, even if the torrent already exists for that particular download, if that makes sense. So for that, we're going to use something called Qubit Manage, which is going to be in another video. Anyways, guys, I hope that this Crossseed search video was extremely helpful. I tried my best to cover pitfalls that happened to me, and I tried to cover all these options as well. API auth, Qubit torrent URL, exclude older, exclude SERS, fuzzy. I tried to cover, once again, in summation, Crossseed is a script that works in torrent matching mode by default, and you can have a data matching mode backup if you define certain things in the options, such as data directories, etc. Alternatively, you can do what I did and force data matching mode only by pointing it to a blank directory and tricking Crossseed. You have two options, inject or save. Inject the torrents or save them to output directory. You have two matching modes, safe and risky. Safe matches based on size and name, risky only on size. It might use the release group if it's there, but it'll grab things anyways if it's not. Again, guys, I highly recommend that you use this video as a supplement and check out the handy guide here that I refer to throughout the video. You read everything. This video isn't a substitute for reading everything. Read the FAQ and troubleshooting. There's a lot in here that I didn't cover that, might be relevant to your situation, such as I'm getting errors in Crossseed on hosting by design Seedbox, etc., which is beyond the scope of this video. Okay, guys, take care. See you on the next one, which will probably be Qubit Manage.